the worst angels of our nature, immoral leadership in high places, with Joe Chuman. Joe is the leader of the Ethical Society of Bergen County, New Jersey, and he's been there since 1974. Before that, he was the leader of the Essex Ethical Society and leader in training at the Bergen and New York societies. He served as the leadership committee of the AEU American Ethical Union for over 20 years and was president of the National Leaders Council for 6 years. Joe is a representative from AEU to the International Humanist and Ethical Union and was co-mentor of the 6th class of humanist institutes, also serving on the institute board. Joe has a PhD in religion from Columbia University. He teaches some seminars in human rights and human and religion to graduate students of Columbia University. He advises them in the development of their dissertations. He helps advance their studies through internships and in the international community. He also teaches human rights to undergraduates at the Honors College of Hunter College. Formerly, he taught at the United Nations University for Peace in Costa Rica and Fairleigh Dickinson University, and Joe has been a leader in the society since 2008. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you, Bonnie. Thank you so much for bringing your warmth and dedication to the platform this morning, and a warm greeting to all of you. I wish it would stop raining, don't you? I mean, it's just raining. And I want to extend a special greeting to all of you who are fathers, as I am, and tell them, your kids, that I told you that they have to be nice to you today, especially, right? I assume they're nice every day, aren't they? But today they have to put aside all their grievances and upsets and peeves and be especially nice. So I'm looking forward to my children being nice to me too. So let me start my address this morning with a preface that I feel is conscientiously necessary. There was a terrible shooting, of course, in Washington, D.C. just a few days ago, and it has generated discourse about how language and the climate that we're in generally foments violence. And I've got to look at this very seriously because this is something like the 7th or 8th address that I'll be giving on the current administration and the perils that I see that Donald Trump and those around him and his administration bring to our fundamental values of democracy and freedom in America, which of course are fundamental values of ethical culture too. And I must admit the language that I've used is not characteristic of the language I generally in years past have employed from the platform. It's been much stronger and much more critical and harsher. And therefore, I'm forced to really reflect conscientiously as to whether I've contributed to an atmosphere that could indeed segue and generate violence. And it raises certain questions about the prudent use of language. We're not talking about the right of free speech. We're talking about the responsible use of that right. And my own feeling is that we have to veer clear, and I have conscientiously, I believe, veering clear of language that segues into or is expressive of incitement to violence. I think that is never justified, or is incendiary. And I don't think that that's the language I've used, albeit very strong and critical. On the other hand, I don't think, given the dangers we're in and given the fact that we are Americans who have a right to enjoy the First Amendment and to use the right of free expression, I don't think we should be cowed into silence either. I don't think silence or muffling our speech in times of great danger, and I believe this republic is in great danger, I don't think muffling our speech either is justified. Therefore, I would defend my own use of language by saying, as strong as it may be, as strident, as critical, sometimes veering into name-calling, that it is in effect proportionate, not disproportionate or excessive given the dangers that we confront. As I reflect, of course you can't be a judge in your own trial, but as far as I reflect on my own use of language, I've tried not to veer, and I don't think I have veered into the incendiary, the inflammatory, or certainly not incitement. And I will continue to speak in strong language because I think, again, the dangers we face are unparalleled and very great. I think that
our democratic institutions and democratic way of life could indeed, given a congeries and confluence of forces, flip very quickly. And I think could flip very quickly. Could flip very quickly. And I think what we have to do is reinvigorate our institutions on the ground to ensure that that does not happen as best as we can. So that's the position I take. Felix Adler, the founder of Ethical Culture, when asked about the purpose of the movement he started, responded by saying that its highest purpose is to nurture in each man and woman what he referred to as, quote, ethical personality. By ethical personality, he meant our ability to recognize moral ideals, affirm their importance, and strive to live by them. By trial and error over a lifetime, he believed we could refine our characters and inch ever closer to the ideal while, of course, never achieving it. For us mortals, ideals inspire, but their attainment, by definition, is always beyond our reach. That's the nature of ideals. Adler believed that the best way to move towards ethical personality is by actively engaging in the lives of our fellow human beings and in the life of our community. There is no substitute for experience. But he also said that it would be helpful from time to time to read the biographies of morally illustrious women and men. We human beings are social creatures, and as such we learn from others. This pertains not only to intellectual knowledge, but more intimately with regard to learning how to be a human being among other human beings. We learn from others in order to grow into ourselves. When we are small, much of this learning starts by imitation. As we grow older, imitation may morph into its softer variant of emulation. And later, we developmentally make use of inspiration in order to become the type of person we want to be. Though everyone prides himself in being an autonomous individual, it's my view that holding other people as objects of regard and esteem is a profound need of the human soul. If this were not the case, we would not have Hollywood actors or rock stars or sports figures to attract our attention and sometimes fixate on. In similar regard, I believe that authority is also a deep-seated human need. We often find need to respect and esteem our teachers, our mentors, our coaches, and other significant people in our lives. And by definition, of course, we esteem our heroes. We need to look up to others for guidance, for leadership, for knowledge and wisdom, and perhaps to compensate for the confidence and strength that we ourselves lack. Let me be clear. I make a difference between giving adulation to legitimate authority on the one hand and authoritarianism on the other. They're not the same thing. Authoritarianism is arbitrary authority that people follow for bad reasons. But I think there's a place in life, and this makes me, I'm revealing myself to be partially conservative in this regard. I believe that there is a place for legitimate authority in life. I'll give you an example. Dr. Adler's son-in-law, Professor Horace Friess, was a leader of the New York Society part-time. He was an esteemed professor at Columbia University, a professor of religion and philosophy. He was an older man, and I was one of his mentors, part of a small class of ethical leaders back in the late 1960s. And Horace was the type of guy whom you'd want to respect. It was never Horace, it was always Dr. Friess. And he had the type of persona and the type of background and learning. Okay, he was a very, very learned man. The type of learning where you wanted to respect him. You wanted to give deference to his authority. And I think that that need to honor people who are legitimate authorities in our lives, I think is a legitimate need of being a human being. I don't think there's anything necessarily, as I'm saying, anything necessarily wrong with this. Indeed, it's a very human disposition. In my view, it's a personal limitation, I think. A limitation and a misfortune. If a person is so cynical and misanthropic that he or she cannot admire another human being. As Adler again put it, we live in the radiations of other people, including those whom we look up to. But beyond respect, esteem, and admiration, as Sigmund Freud discovered, there's a psychological tendency to project onto others, often in inflated ways, and especially onto authority figures, abilities and virtues that they may not have. This tendency to project magnifies the authority that others have over us, especially in regard to the impression that they leave and in their power to influence our thinking, dispositions, and our behaviors. In psychotherapy, this projection, this quality of projection phenomenon, can be put to good advantage by a skilled therapist. In the hands of others less benign, this projected inflated authority can become oppressive and disastrous. A relative example of this is that Americans tend to project a great deal of authority and influence onto our presidents. You get a sense of where this is going to lead. In significant ways, this projection is analogous to the authority subjects project onto their kings or monarchs in states where monarchies still exist. Beyond the actual political authority and power of the president, I argue that there is an added authority, which is psychological, and strengthens the ability of the head of government to influence and mold attitudes and behaviors of citizens. This includes the power to mold the moral attitudes and dispositions of society at large. This superadded psychological and moral dimension is perhaps clarified in countries where the monarch indeed has little or no political power. The power possessed by the Queen of England, for example, is almost totally symbolic, yet it is great power nevertheless. As an object of respect and veneration, she possesses the power of holding the British people together, of representing their common history, which further binds British subjects to one another, of raising their national pride, and she stands for such values as tradition, honor, nobility, patriotism, and a group narcissism that highlights the uniqueness of the British character and the glory of the British past. Though no doubt the British royal family is almost totally politically powerless, and in a practical sense virtually useless, and moreover a significant drain on the British budget, I suspect that if put to a referendum, a majority of the English would vote to retain the monarchy because of the vitally symbolic and moral functions that it plays in the lives of the British people. Again, the President of the United States, I think, plays an analogous symbolic role in a different key and without the pomp and reverence which accompanies the crown. And there's a great power in that component of his role to shape moral attitudes again and behaviors. We live in our projections, and we live in our symbols. We may not view the president as a symbol of empire, but we do project onto the office and the person of the president certain values, such as honesty, magnanimity, generosity, the dignity of the office, among others. We expect and want our president to exemplify these values, even if he doesn't. And the important point is that because of his unique and extraordinary authority and power, the president reciprocally reinforces these values and others in society at large. In short, the President of the United States has two lines of authority and two agendas. The first relates obviously from the policies and programs that he proclaims and he executes. The second is his moral authority, which devolves from the moral values that he himself exemplifies, augmented by the authority that people project onto him and project onto the office. In other words, the president, in addition to other things, is unavoidably a most powerful moral teacher, and by the value of his own moral behavior can serve to strengthen or weaken the moral fiber of society as a whole. For example, many of you, not me, but I suspect people in the audience remember the moral, perhaps you do, maybe I'm overstating, the moral authority of Franklin Roosevelt, okay, and the persona that he projected and the type of way in which that uplifted the American citizenry. And I certainly remember John Kennedy and the role of his persona in terms of really inspiring and energizing the values and moral dispositions and moral attitudes of a generation. In fact, considering society as a whole, it's hard to imagine a more influential moral teacher in the American context than the president. It should be more than clear, again, where I'm going with this platform. But before I get to the case at hand, one more general point. Shared moral values, I think, are one of the most powerful forces that holds a society, that hold a society together. These shared moral values, in fact, are our social glue. Take, for example, the most basic assumption, namely that people are generally honest and seek to tell the truth under normal circumstances. If we could not hold, friends, if we could not hold to this fundamental assumption, there could be no trust among people at large. And if there were no trust among us, each of us would be isolated and alone. No society, in fact, would be possible. And because we all need each other to survive, we would all soon perish in our isolation. But the assumption is generally, we walk into the world assuming that others, strangers, and so forth, will sort of lean on the side of being honest rather than willfully deceptive. I mean, if I need directions from a stranger, and I ask a stranger directions, I assume that that person is going to try to be accurate. Now, you may be wrong, but their intentionality is to basically be honest with me. And I think that society as a whole, our social glue, is dependent on that presumption, that prior presumption of honesty, unless we have reasons, concrete reasons, to be skeptical. At the deepest level, society and the very existence of all individuals who make it up are dependent, as I'm saying, on the moral value of honesty. When that value is undermined or weakened, society itself is eroded. We often assume that law backed up by executive power is the force that holds us together as a society. And this is certainly true. But I think that further reflection brings us to the realization that law, which is a very powerful civilizing element, an essential one, is itself built upon a substructure of shared moral convictions. It's often said that law can regulate behavior, but you cannot legislate morality. This, I think, is mostly true, but it's not totally true in my view. By constraining behaviors through fear of punishment, which is what the law does, over time, by acting differently, I think people's values, moral values, slowly can and do change. I'm a bit of a behaviorist. I mean, if you spend your life crawling on the floor searching for paper clips, after a while you're going to begin to care about it. Okay, that indeed it's behavior that induces, and the law plays that role in terms of fashioning attitudes and values. However, it's complicated. I assert that it's mostly the other way around. Moral attitudes and conventions first percolate up from the ground, and then we write laws, we draft laws which reflect these emerging values and conventions, and then strive to enforce them. For example, we have new laws that protect gay marriage, laws that did not exist 20 years ago. But before we had such laws, where did those laws come from? Before we had such laws, we first had to have a change in values, attitudes, conventions, and norms, and the laws were then written afterwards to reflect these changes on the ground that first had to come into existence. Moral values are the foundation, the substructure of society, laws, the superstructure. I'd like to tell my human rights students that human rights are encoded into international law, did not emerge full-blown out of the mind of some legal philosopher with a spontaneous birth as if they came from the head of Zeus. But human rights and its laws, whether the right to free speech or the right to practice your religion, the right to healthcare, etc., emerged out of concrete historical struggles at various points in history as a result of changing moral values and changed conditions. So it is with law in general and its basis, its foundation in morality. So here the two pillars of my talk come together in the person of Donald J. Trump. The president who, by virtue of his office and personal authority, has great power to shape moral values for good or ill, and the place of morality in serving as the glue upon which a civilized life and the very fabric of society depends. Though difficult to gauge with great accuracy, it is my view that the destruction to the moral fiber of American society wielded by this man, Trump, is incalculably great. This destruction emanates both from the nether reaches of his dark and disturbed character and from the moral consequence of the policies to which he is dedicated. And though I abjure simplistic and facile psychologizations of human behaviors, including political behavior, it is difficult to conclude that his policies or to deny that his policies are a pretty direct product of that dark character. First, I want to deal with a historical, parenthetically, with a historical aside. Let me
Let me deal with a historical aside.
When I think of Donald Trump and the morality that underlies his political worldview, my mind turns to the 17th century political philosopher Thomas Hobbes. It was Thomas Hobbes who created the modern democratic state in which the power of government comes not from God above, as it did in the Middle Ages, but from the people below. But Hobbes's state is not one that you or I would want to live in. Hobbes's state is one to which the is one in which the state is autocratic and all-powerful, and the people in it have but one right, that is the right to life, which it is the obligation of the state to protect. And why does Hobbes promote a state that is all-powerful, The answer lies in his understanding of human nature. For Hobbes, the human being is nothing other than a biological creature motivated by his instincts and drives. Furthermore, for Hobbes, the human being has no cooperative or social instinct. Rather, he proclaims that the human individual, underscoring the word individual, the human individual by nature is nothing other than an egoistical, aggressive, and selfish. And in a state of freedom, men left to their own devices would, in short order, end up killing each other, and anarchy would reign. And so we need an all-powerful, tyrannical state, what Hobbes calls the Leviathan. We need an all-powerful state to almost literally sit on top of society in order to prevent human beings from doing each other in. Indeed, Hobbes had compelling reason to feel this way, since he was witness to the great wars of religion between Catholics and Protestants, in which those factions were saturating the soil of Europe with endless pools of blood. Indeed, for Hobbes, as he put it, the state of human society was nothing other than a war of each against all. And in a famous line from his seminal political treatise called The Leviathan, Thomas Hobbes describes human nature by saying that the life of man, I think everybody's probably heard this description, the life of man is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short, end quote. It's a real downer. Okay, if you want to feel depressed, you can read Thomas Hobbes. 17th century treatise, and I had to read it in 17th century English, my goodness. So, okay, it's a grim vision. And maybe I'm giving Donald Trump more credit than he deserves, but I tend to think that Trump's vision of the world is not all that much different from that put forward by Thomas Hobbes. Indeed, Trump, counseled by the likes of Steve Bannon, frequently depicts the American condition in dystopian, dark, apocalyptic terms which resonate, I argue, with a Hobbesian worldview. When it comes to the destruction of moral values, it seems that Trump is a type of anti-moral figure, if such an individual could possibly exist. What follows are some points in evidence which are probably as well known to you as they are to me. Take, for example, Trump's disastrous decision to remove the United States from the Paris Climate Accords. I have trouble listening to this stuff. I really do. It's hard for me to listen. But I actually brought myself to listen to that speech around when we declared that we're removing ourselves from the Paris Agreement. I listened to a speech which was bolstered with the incantations of self-contradictory statements and dubious facts. But the tone of it was extremely distressing and typically Trump. Its essential narrative was a whining screed as to how America is continuously victimized by foreign powers. What Paris is, he proclaimed, is primarily a giveaway of billions of dollars to foreign countries that have already taken our jobs from us. Much is demanded of us, he asserted, but nothing of them, which leaves them, as he said, laughing at us. Trump frequently describes the United States as a victim of China, a victim of terrorists, a victim of immigrants, a victim of other nations that don't pay their share. And one has to conclude that he is, again, appealing to his base of Midwestern older white folks who themselves feel themselves victims by outside predatory forces. There's a conjunction between, I think, the psychological dispositions of the people he appeals to and the way in which he structures his moral universe, where we collectively as a nation are victims. It's victimization that has a powerful resonance. There may be something, I think, of a self-fulfilling prophecy in Trump's cries of victimhood. By pulling out of the Paris Accord, for example, we are ceding world leadership to the Chinese, who are racing ahead to fill the vacuum left by America and capture the burgeoning market created by the alternative energy revolution. For more than 80 years, the United States was leader on the world stage with a unique role in international affairs. But history will note, sadly, that it was Donald Trump who removed us from that stage. And for what purpose? To create a few dirty fossil fuel jobs in West Virginia? Which, I mean, it's really, there's no rationality to it on a rational basis, the economic basis, the policy doesn't make sense. But I contend that there is little dignity. My argument is there's little dignity in being a victim. By portraying the United States in victimized terms, Trump deflates our national pride while raising the dynamics of anger, revenge, if not violence, in his followers. At least it's an exceedingly small-minded way to appeal to one's constituency. Moreover, this dynamic of victimization, which divides the world into victims and their victimizers, is, I believe, a component of Trump's larger worldview that explains much about his policies and his persona. Look at it this way for a moment. Broadly speaking, we can assess human moral dispositions as on a continuum with competition on one end and cooperation on the other. On the individual level, competition is predicated on a self-protective, self-centered orientation in which people are driven to maximize their power and dominion over others. Amassing power, whether physical strength, wealth, or brute control, is the name of the game. The competitive drive and what flows from it is based on a selfishness and reflects a Hobbesian view of oneself, others, and how people behave. This explains, I believe, Donald Trump both in terms of his policies, again, and his personality. His commitment to America first is grounded in a competitive ethos and selfishness writ large. It's a valorization of nationalism that pits America against the world, a world which is poised to take advantage of us and do us in. It is either us or them, and he sees others, whether foreign nations or immigrants again, as the enemy. It is for this reason that Trump is an isolationist who decries globalism. He has no commitment to diplomacy and is dedicated to increasing still further America's military power, including weaponry that in great measure is not even functional or relevant in military conflicts in the 21st century. He seeks to inflate still further an overly inflated Pentagon, while positions and offices in the State Department remain vacant. The West has worked hard, and we've worked hard since World War II to build up a structure of global international alliances through diplomacy, trade, and creating an elaborate but fragile architecture of human rights. But in 4 brief months, Trump is destroying that architecture and America's place in the world with breathtaking speed. Trump is contemptuous of this international arrangement. He places a premium on hard power and sees no value in so-called soft power. That is the security and influence that America has achieved in the eyes of the world through being a beacon of democracy, for standing for human rights, through foreign aid for the development of poor countries, that has provided for maternal health, has assisted in eradicating dreaded diseases, that has been a haven of security for refugees and victims of war, for being a place where foreign graduate students could come to get a first-class education. My president at Columbia, Lee Bollinger, just had an article in the Columbia magazine in which he was interviewed, and he said, you know, Columbia is having a harder time attracting international students. I teach international students. They're having a harder time. In other words, America's become so unfriendly, it's put up so many barriers to, do you know what I'm saying, immigration, that universities are beginning to feel this. That's not good. If we want to make America great again, we don't do it by closing ourselves off to the best minds and so on, and people come here. Very big problem. If America has been great, I think it's been because it has been a standard bearer to the world of these humane values. Not that we've upheld them, of course, has been a standard bearer to this world of these humane values, which have rightly been a source of pride and, in fact, have made us stronger. Trump seems not to understand this, or he doesn't care, as he pursues an almost adolescent commitment to brute power, predicated again on a competitive worldview and an ethos of national selfishness. But human beings are more than selfish and competitive. They are also human beings. We are also altruistic and cooperative. David Brooks of the New York Times is an essayist whom I don't always admire, but sometimes I think he gets it right. Such was the case in a column about 2 weeks ago in the Times, and I want to quote from it. It's actually a very nicely written statement. He says, powerful, selfish people have always adopted a dirty-minded realism to justify their own selfishness. The problem is that this philosophy is based on an error about human beings, and it leads to self-destructive behavior in all cases. The error is that it misunderstands what drives human actions. Of course, people are driven by selfish motivations for individual status, wealth, and power, but they are also motivated by another set of drives for solidarity, love, and moral fulfillment that are equally and sometimes more powerful. Let me just say parenthetically, we in the ethical society are predicated on that faith, on that assumption, on that side of the ledger. Okay, we're based on it. People are wired, he says, to cooperate. Far from being a flimsy thing, the desire for cooperation is the primary human evolutionary advantage we have over other animals. People have a moral sense. They have a set of universal intuitions that help establish harmony between people. From their first moments, children are wired to feel each other's pain. You don't have to teach a child about what fairness is. They already know. There's no society on earth where people are admired for running away in battle or for lying to their friends. People have moral emotions. They feel rage at injustice, disgust towards greed, reverence for excellence, awe before the sacred, and elevation in the face of goodness. People yearn for righteousness. They want to feel meaning and purpose in their lives, that their lives are oriented toward the good. People are attracted by goodness and repelled by selfishness, end quote. I think we can feel this. You know, we very often feel this, and there are many examples we can admirably bring forward in ethical culture. But I remember an incident just a few weeks ago, took place in Portland, Oregon, where there were two women, both Muslims, one was an African-American, and they were attacked by a white supremacist on a trolley car in Portland. And three guys, strangers, stood up to intercede, to defend these women. Okay, Muslim, one of them obviously was ostensibly a Muslim woman to defend. Two of them lost their lives, and another one ended up in the hospital. Well, that speaks to human nature too. Okay, and we can of course all point to very, very admirable examples, selfless examples, of how human beings behave. But Donald Trump, again, seems to have no sense of these values, and therefore all of us are paying a very heavy price for it. But this competitive, selfish ethos centered on combativeness and brute power is manifest in his persona as well as his policies. As we all know, his personal ethics are vile, thuggish, and incalculably disgusting. More appropriate, I would say, seriously, for Nazi brown shirts than the President of the United States and leader of the free world. Refrains of lock her up, his inciting violence at his rallies, his crude and obscene disparaging of women are shocking, or maybe we've seen so much of it that we're no longer shocked. But the larger picture is vested in the social consequences of our president's behavior. I contend that the damage done to the moral fabric of our society is both ominous and very lamentable. With the election of Barack Obama to the presidency, I personally really did think that America was turning a corner and trying hard, not succeeding all the way, of course, but trying hard to put our ugly legacy of racism and hatred of the other behind us. But Donald Trump, as we know, has given every bigot, racist, xenophobe, misanthrope, anti-Semite, and all-purpose hater legitimacy to come out of the closet and spew his hatred with abandon and with sanction of the most powerful person in the land. To turn a beautiful phrase rendered by Abraham Lincoln on its head, Trump appeals to what we might call the worst angels of our nature. I can only imagine the challenge of parents, I don't have small children anymore, I can only imagine the challenge of parents who needing to contend with the dangers of drugs, premature sexuality, of predatory and sleazy entertainment, and commercial culture, now in addition have to concoct for their nine-year-olds explanation for their president's behavior, okay, and have to try to shield Trump or their children from Trump as one would try to protect them from an X-rated movie or some form of obscenity. Seriously, I mean, this is the challenge I think parents confront, rather than seeing the president in positive terms, right? But of course, there's much more that reveals what kind of strange man. Yeah. Okay, you can't hear me back there. Okay, I'll speak louder. Okay, well, I don't want to keep you too long. That's why I'm talking fast.
But if, put this on the top of your tie.
Put this on the top. You know, these days, you got to be socialized. I hear you. That's very nice of you. You know, these days with the technology, you've got to realize that for the first 10 minutes of any gathering, you've got to fiddle with the technology. You've got to have it right, you've got to deal with it. Right, you got to read the microphone's got to be right, you've got to deal with that. People, you know, put their PowerPoint up there and they can't get it to work, you know, it's part of our life. Right, a refrain I often like to invoke, and I've invoked it here, so I'm repeating myself. Margaret Mead, who used to speak here, in fact, once said, "We don't have to worry about the fascists taking over. They'll never get the machines to work properly." Maybe there's some hope in that. Right. Anyway, there's much more we could say that is revelatory of the strangeness of our president. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good. I must admit, I did read with some lurid fascination, just to say, show you that I'm not always so high-minded, and I guess can indulge in a little bit of schadenfreude, which is not one of our more admirable emotions, I might dare say. But I did read with some fascination the following description, penned by the journalist Elizabeth Drew, has a very venerable reputation, in the current edition of the New York Review of Books. She writes as follows. It's insightful. From the stories that emanate from 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, the impression one gets is that Trump is a nearly impossible person to work for. He screams at his staff when they tell him something he doesn't want to hear. He screams at them because he watches television news for hours on end and sees stories about himself that he doesn't like, which is most of the time. Some White House staff are polishing their resumes. That's good to hear. Leaks are also being made by the intelligence community, many of whom see Trump as a national menace. People who have been to the Oval Office have come away stunned by Trump's minimal attention span, his appalling lack of information, his tendency to say more than he knows. Listen to this. Intelligence officials have been instructed to put as much of his daily briefing as possible in the form of pictures. Our president needs cartoons in order, essentially, to basically, I mean, this is really, you know, this is really upsetting stuff. Aides have been subjected to public embarrassments by his propensity for changing his story, end quote. And we can wonder how long these aides can continue to cover for him as they twist themselves into pretzels before they break. And all of us are probably asking ourselves how and when this nightmare is going to end. One can look at the moral earnestness. I think one can look at the moral earnestness by comparison. Look at the moral earnestness of a Jimmy Carter or the exemplary dignity of a Barack Obama. We can look at that and only weep at what our current situation is. If I had 100 hours for this platform, I would not have nearly enough time to enumerate and expound on the immoral qualities of our current president and the damage inflicted on our society and our planet. The litany, tragically, is very long. You know that. But beyond the nationalistic, power-amassing, egoistic, competitive worldview, beyond the thorough lack of concern for others, the lack of compassion and empathy as manifested in the disparaging of vulnerable immigrants, refugees, the disabled, and as manifested, I think, in his sadistic healthcare plan, even perhaps more than his thuggery, the most damaging to the moral fabric of American society may be the pervasive mendacity of this man, which he yields with total abandon and seemingly with no sense of inconsistency, shame, or conscience. Needless to say, all politicians lie. All politicians exaggerate. We know that. In fact, we expect it. We can almost say that it goes with the territory. But Donald Trump is in a category all of his own. Like a five-year-old, he just makes things up. He seems to live much of his life in his own illusions. For other people in public office, lying may still be the exception, but with Donald Trump, it's the norm. He lies continuously, transparently, and one is left totally at sea, not knowing if anything coming out of his mouth is truthful. We are left floating in an ocean of lies and totally ungrounded. When the President of the United States evinces no respect for honesty whatsoever, I believe this is very destructive, and at least for two reasons. First, if the President has no regard for the truth and lies either on whim or when it suits his interests to lie, then he is sending a powerful message. I am sure that there are many people with shady commitments to honesty to begin with who look at the president in his exemplary role and conclude if the president can lie for his reasons, then I can lie for mine. I can act on impulse as the president does and not be bothered by standards of honesty and truthfulness. Again, if truthfulness is the mortar that holds society together, then Donald Trump is potentially doing great damage to social cohesion and the medium of honest discourse and loyalty to facts that people must maintain for the social fabric to maintain strong, and he certainly debases the level, generally speaking, of discourse in the culture as a whole. But having a president who is a chronic liar is incalculably dangerous for national security, your security and mine. I've always been skeptical of what presidents have to say. But beyond my skepticism, I also believe that they were sometimes telling the truth. And I have felt it important to bring my critical faculties to bear to try to determine when they are being truthful and when they're not. But with Donald Trump, my skepticism, and perhaps yours, is total. I believe this president can never be trusted, that he is never telling the truth. And of course, I'm not the only one to feel this way. But if the president cannot be believed, what will happen in the case of a national emergency? What will eventuate, as is plausible, friends, as is plausible that the United States will suffer another serious terrorist assault? Or maybe Kim Jong-un will lob a missile that hits Guam or the banks of Alaska, and the president needs to summon the American people and our allies to respond. What will happen, given that Trump has zero credibility and simply can't be believed? Your imagination is as prescient as mine, and I don't think the answer, in any case, is going to be a very good one. In closing, we are on a very wild ride, and dark and dangerous turns will be with us for times unknown. Let us hope that it's short. In the meanwhile, we can take some hope from the resistance to the Trump nightmare continues. And I'm pleased and proud that the ethical movement, this society and others, are part of that resistance. Okay, Felix Adler felt that in pursuit of our ideals, we always bump up against frustration. And what frustration can do very often is cause us to struggle harder for those ideals, not generate despair, but clarify those ideals that we stand for and struggle for them with greater energy and commitment. I take inspiration from the innumerable rallies that continue to emerge throughout the country. I take hope from those mayors who have declared their city sanctuaries in defiance of an inhumane deportation policy. I love that states, including California, New York, Washington, and many cities, and innumerable corporations who have been the bastions of conservatism, including Mirabilu Dictu, ExxonMobil, have declared their allegiance to the Paris Climate Agreement. They're contacting the Secretary General and asking, can cities sign on to the Paris Agreement? Does it have to be a country? Can cities do it? Can corporations do it? I think that's amazingly, that's where the hope comes from. I mean, as Trump was pulling us out of the climate accord, Jerry Brown, governor of California, was leaving for China to represent California, the world's sixth largest economy, okay, in the Paris process. I think that we need that, friends. I mean, that's the sign, that's hope, that's democracy in action. And we've got to, you know, understand that, appreciate, and be part of it. We can take hope, I think, in this resistance. And I say, may it continue. May it spread wider across the land, and may it grow stronger and louder. And as this darkness lifts, may we usher in a new day and a new enlightened leadership that with intelligence and dignity will evoke from us the better angels of our nature.